Good afternoon. I have a couple of questions for you before we get started. And I think the questions are motivated to get you to think about our current situation in the United States in terms of education, innovation, and wealth. True or false? The United States has more billionaires than anywhere in the world.
True.
That's correct. True or false? More patent applications have been filed from the United States than any other country.
True.
Correct. Fewer than half of high school graduates in the US are ready for college level math. True or false?
True.
Correct. We won't get there. Fewer than 5% of college degrees awarded in the US are in engineering. True or false?
True.
That's correct. So I hope that you understand just from these four questions that we actually live in a crisis, but we also live in a time of opportunity. Let me talk about Arizona in particular. Arizona ranks 48th in the country in student spending and education. But we ranked first in the country of professional baseball games per capita. 637 games per year, in case anybody is wondering. That's almost like having a doubleheader every day of the year. So think about that. This presents an opportunity then to use baseball, which this is the hotbed, literally, of baseball, and use it to leverage our situation or to improve our situation in education. Now, as an educator and as a baseball fan, I love science, technology, engineering, and math, STEM, which coincidentally is Mets backwards. So what I want to talk about you today are three things. Number one, math is abstract, and that's a bit of a problem for students. So we'll talk about how to resolve that. Number two, math is scary for students, and so we'll talk about some solutions to that. And the issue is those two are reinforcing. It's abstract, so it becomes scary. And it's abstract, so it's still scary, no matter what grade level you're at. So we have to break that cycle. The third thing is we don't have enough opportunities to provide hands-on learning in schools. So we'll talk about some solutions for that as well. Okay? So let me talk about the first issue, which is math being too abstract. And we can mostly blame the Greeks and some French mathematicians and some Brits as well. So people like Euler, Laplace, Descartes, and they're the ones who came up with a lot of these concepts that we use today, and they're very exciting. They actually help innovation, but they don't necessarily allow a third grader to figure out how to get through the day. I mean, let's be honest. When was the last time the Pythagorean Theorem helped you get through the workday? Okay? But it turns out the Pythagorean Theorem is a very powerful tool in baseball. So let's do a little bit of math. Here's a right triangle. The distance between home plate and first base is 90 feet. So if you draw a right triangle, that could be one of the sides. And we already know the distance, 90. The distance between first base and second base is also 90 feet. So now we know the distance of two of the sides of the triangle. We can solve for the third. You square 90, and you add it to another square of 90, and you get the distance from home plate to second base. And if you did that in your head, it's 127 or so. So good job. So now we know. Now we know how far the catcher needs to throw the ball to get to second base in order to throw a runner out that may be stealing from first to second. See, so that's what can help us make math less abstract by applying it to a real situation. Okay, let me give you another example. Let's talk about torque. I could just tell a student torque equals force times distance. But that's not gonna mean much unless you talk about a teeter-totter. And in this particular teeter-totter, we're balancing two different forces. On the left side is a 70-pound fourth grader. On the right side is a 140-pound mascot. That's Baxter the cat for the Diamondbacks. So how do we balance the two sides if the forces are different? Well, the rule in torque is you change the distance of the beam between the beam and the fulcrum, the point where the two sides are being balanced. Okay, so you'll notice that they are standing a different distance from the fulcrum. So that's how the two sides, the two torques, are equal to each other. There's nobody touching the beam. There's somebody there just for safety. But you can see that the student now appreciates what torque is, because if she didn't, she'd fall over and hit her head, right? So our goal is to make the math and the science so simple that even Yankee fans will understand it. I'm wearing a Mets shirt, so you have to understand that. Let's talk about the angle of trajectory of a home run. We could just tell the students that the optimal angle of flight for a sphere is 45 degrees. But they'll never really remember that unless we do an experiment. And they'll also realize that the most of the math that you learn, there's an assumption that you're dealing with a sphere. This is not a sphere, folks. This is a baseball. And it has seams and stitches. 216 of them, to be exact. I counted them. So that means that the aerodynamics of a baseball are different than a sphere. So the optimal angle of trajectory for a home run is not 45 degrees. So what we do is we set up an experiment for students to think about, hey, how do we derive the actual value of the optimal angle of trajectory for a home run? So let's set up an experiment, okay? Professional baseball field, check. Baseballs, check. Water balloon launchers, check. Giant protractors, check. We're ready to go. Now we're doing science. So we hold all the variables constant, that is how much tension or force you're pulling on the ball, and the only thing that we change is the angle at which the ball is being launched. And students intuitively know that if you launch something at a straight angle, it's probably going to be a line drive or a ground ball. And if you launch something at too high of an angle, it's going to be a pop fly. So they're trying to find what is the optimal angle of trajectory. So this is an empirical experiment. And they learn very quickly that it's not 45 degrees. It's more like 35 or 30 degrees. And then you can compare that to real data of home runs because we have all that data available to us. Baseball truly is a statistician's wet dream because all this great data is available. Most of you have heard of Moneyball. Moneyball is really based on the idea of sabermetrics, which is using data to try to find inefficiencies in the market, okay? And I lived in Boston, actually, during the time of when the curse of the Bambino was broken. So I became a bit of a fan, and after winning the first World Series in 86 years, you sort of tend to gravitate towards that emotion. And what I learned is that baseball really, or Boston in particular, was really a baseball crazy town. But then I moved to Arizona and I realized that this is really the crazy baseball town, which is great. So what baseball provides is a laboratory for experimentation and a laboratory for learning. Physiology, biomechanics, statistics, geometry. So we not only teach them how to play baseball, but we also teach them how to use their math and science skills and challenges in order to understand the game better. Okay, so let's talk about the third issue, which is not enough opportunities for hands-on learning in the classroom. So what we've done with our Science of Baseball program in Arizona, California, Illinois, and even Australia, is we've created a curriculum for teachers. They take the lessons, and they take a kit of materials, everything they need to run these lessons, baseball cards, water balloon launchers, heart rate monitors, all the materials that they need to make the baseball field the classroom. So we empower these teachers, and that becomes our point of impact or our leverage point. Because for every teacher that we train, they can directly impact 30 kids, at least 30 kids. So far, we've trained 200 teachers in Arizona. Do the math, 200 times 30, 6,000 students. That's just in Arizona. And we're growing this program worldwide. Now, the idea is not to stop with baseball, actually. We've also created the Science of Soccer program. We're in conversations with some football teams. Heck, I've even been asked to do Science of Cricket, okay? So a couple of interesting unintended consequences have come from this. The first one is that these teachers end up creating their own lessons, which is fantastic. That's what we want to see. We want to empower these teachers to really be the deployment mechanism for the program, okay? The second unintended consequence is that we found students have taken their interest in sports, and that's translated into other things on their campus, such as science fair projects. So we've seen the number of science fair projects increase in terms of their application to sports. So one particular example at Wickenburg High School here in Arizona was the creation of a baseball bat and wood shop. There's a lot of math involved in designing a baseball bat and optimizing the sweet spot, because that's where you want to hit the ball. So that's been a great second order effect that has grown from our curriculum and our program. The second thing that we found interesting, you notice from this photo as well, is the involvement of girls in the program. It turns out that even though the boys outperform the girls on the baseball field, the girls outperform the boys in the classroom. So it gives them both an opportunity to shine. And this is great, because then the girls end up teaching the boys all the math, and then the boys end up helping the girls on the field. So it really is a nice blend of skills and abilities. Okay? So what I want you to think about is how math and science can help you see the world a little bit differently. Next time you're at a baseball game, I challenge you to do the following. Don't just think about the peanuts and Cracker Jacks. I want you to think about the psychology. What's going on between the pitcher and the batter? I want you to think about the physiology. What's going on in terms of training? Did that player take performance-enhancing drugs? What's going on in terms of the physics? Okay, did the actual batter hit it on the sweet spot? So I challenge you to think about sports and think about math and science together, because it makes them both a lot more interesting. And what I tell students is math and science plus baseball, exponentially awesome. Thank you.